Hello, gang. Hang on a second. Hello. Hello, testing 1, 2, 3. All right, we seem to have connection. All I need now is a few viewers. Welcome back, my name is Dan. And I have just glazed. This whole painting. And I discovered a little while ago that I don't have any liquin. Shee boy. But I did find my missing pencils. So. So I'm doing right now a cross between the fuzz layer and the final edit. Okay, on a weekend like this, I'm trying to tell myself. I don't have time to do all the normal bells and whistles. So I'm going to try to condense my process down just a little bit. Do a combination of fuzz layer and final edit. Which actually, I think if I were a better painter, I would do that all the time. That would be my normal process. But I'm just not that good yet, evidently. I have some stuff that's called oleopasto liquin, so fat, thick liquin. And that's what I'm just gonna get by with. So I'm not completely without a medium, I just don't have the medium that I prefer the most. Really be doing this with slightly larger brushes, shouldn't I? Too late. Hello.
Just watching the artist at work.
Pardon?
Just watching the artist at work.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
No.
Today and tomorrow. Yeah.
Thank you.
to a little bit of a opaque painting here for a minute. That big old whirligig there is blue. So I have some real serious confusion going on when the blue whirligig is up against a blue sky and they're almost the same color. It really is a sky blue whirligig. What color do I do it? Well, I'm going to do that oft-seen trick that the color of the whirligig is going to magically shift. Down here it's one color blue, as it gets up here it's going to shift darker and be silhouetted against the pale blue sky. And the one thing that trick has going for it is that is actually what our eyes literally do. So even though in reality the whirligig of course is painted all the same color blue, your eye does that very trick that I just described. It gets silhouetted against here, so it appears to our brain, to our mind, to be a deeper color than it actually is. Hang on a second, let me switch ear monitors. Got a battery running out. This ear monitor, I'm putting in now, speaks Korean. I don't know how I managed to, you know, one time when I was fiddling with it, trying to fix it, get it to do the right thing, evidently I hit the magic combination of buttons and it started. I think it's Korean. I don't think it's Japanese, I think it's Korean. So I can't understand a thing that. You know, when she tells me like power on, connected and stuff like that, battery low, power off, all that stuff. You gotta love it. All right, let's go back to the sky now. Once again, newcomers here, I am painting, do I have any chats going on? Nope, not really. Is my thing working? Yep, I think it is, all right. I've worn everybody out today. I've already worn everybody out. So that might be a lesson to me. I'll cut down on the broadcasting here a little bit in a minute. Thirsting, extremely dehydrated. Sorry, little note to my wife who just walked up. All right, I'm tired of painting sky, so let's go somewhere else now for a while. of water first. Right at the moment, I'm doing some of my classic fuzz. I'm sorry, you guys, I can't see. Pardon me. A little break while I get a drink of water. Sure.
Thank you very much.
Guys, let me see if I... There, that might be better. Turn around and look for things that are bluish. Let's go down to, let's do some of that brilliant green grass down there foreground. This has really turned into the star of the show, the focal point here of this painting is this streaked sunlight through the grass here. Again, what I typically call fuzz layer. Anything that if I want it to look like it's glowing, like the sun in the grass here, then you give it very soft edges, very soft edges. I'll come back later and do tight stuff on top of this, which will tighten it all up. Just tightening up is easy. You understand in painting? Tightening up is, like for 99% of us, tightening stuff up is our natural disposition, our natural native tongue, and so on. So, you know, you don't have to usually worry about, man, I wonder if I can tighten this up. No, the answer is you can. That's not the challenge. The challenge is loosening up, isn't it? Nice little eagles going on in the background over there. I'll get a notice from YouTube. In fact, they're doing such a good job of covering the eagles that the YouTube computer might actually think it is the eagles. Then I got a worse letter from them. Oh, Oh, I just heard a bang, and it sounded like a piece of my equipment falling on the floor. A little kid's balloon had burst. It took me several seconds. I was looking around. What? Look for something that, you know, fell on the floor and is gurgling out. Glug, 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 glug. That's the kind of stuff that happens to me at a festival like this. I think these guys specialize in Eagles covers. What do you think? I don't know if you can hear them or not. Well, they're doing well. All right, simply because I'm getting tired of that, I'm gonna quit doing that and go back to doing some pencil now. We got the ball, we make it, we go inside. How are y'all doing? I sure am ignoring you really well today. Forgive me. There's two reasons for that. One, believe it or not, out here in the broad daylight, it is nearly impossible to see a cell phone screen. It's really amazing. They seem plenty bright all the rest of the time, but when you take them outdoors, my goodness, they go black. So it's pretty hard for me to see what's going on. But thanks for watching anyway. I can see my no chats yet. If you leave a chat, that'll let me know that somebody's actually paying attention. And that's all right. If you're not, that's all right too. Probably a couple hundred people will watch this in the next day or so. At least take a glance at it. I don't know. Oh, here, there's a good little kid putting his hand on his mom's shoulder, begging for stuff. I recognize that gesture. Mom. It's about a 9-year-old, 10-year-old kid. Mama. Can I get an elephant ear? Mama. Can I get an elephant ear? Mama. Here's Dad. He's walking back here to safe distance.
Looking good.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Oh, good. Just put it in the basket. You know, if somebody steals it, they got issues. They got issues. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. My wife finally went and got my bookmarks. I think I told you. Well, you guys haven't heard it. You're whatever. Quiet people. I cut up failure paintings, old maid paintings that just aren't ever going to get finished probably, you know. Cut them up into bookmarks and sell them at festivals for $1 each. over the 10 years I tried, you know, $5, $10, $5, $4, $2, $1 seems to be the price break. People will actually buy them for $1, and that's fine with me. I'm certainly not getting my money's worth out of those paintings, but they come, the money, the one, two, or three, the $20 that I'll get this weekend comes at a really good time, because that'll buy me a bag of kettle corn. Everybody knows that's what it's really all about, is buying kettle corn or elephant ears, you know. All right, there's a lot of representational stuff. Well executed right there. And I think some very believable figures, so that helps me relax quite a bit when I get those okay, and there was a dog down here at one time. He's been wiped out repeatedly. But I'm gonna try to put him in here again. Dogs are a nice people touch. Makes my people look more believable if there's a dog in there. Isn't that funny? Same thing if there's a baby carriage. It makes my people look more believable if there's something besides people in there. So a dog and a baby stroller are two good options. You know, I've talked about this before. All human beings, unless they have drunk the Kool-Aid. Now, boy, I tell you, in my old age, I'm taking a detour here. In my older years, I'm developing a very strong, I don't know what the word is, attitude about higher education. I mean, you know, don't get me wrong. I have a master's degree, bachelor's degree, and a master's degree. So I have my share of educational degrees. But my growing impression, and this, if you have a PhD, don't take this on. But many people have PhDs because they don't know what else to do. Not all. Don't get me wrong. But if you got a PhD, if you're honest, you got to admit that a lot of your fellow PhDers, that fits their that describes them pretty well. In fact, when I was in getting a master's degree, somebody said to me one time, you know that old thing, those who can do, those who can't teach? Do you remember that expression? Well, he said, those who can do, those who can't go on to get PhDs. And tragically, I'm sorry, if you know anything about the upper levels of higher education, that is so, so true, tragically true. Anyway, let me go back to what I was starting to say now. All human beings, except those who have higher degrees, art degrees, in which case they have drunk the Kool-Aid and drunk it to the dregs. I'm talking MFA, it's pretty much the terminal degree. You get a doctorate in art history, but you, anyway. Unless you have an MFA, I'll just put it bluntly, unless you have an MFA, all human beings get a kick out of, enjoy seeing a thing faithfully rendered by a human being, by hand. It's just one of those strange things. Now, please understand, if you have a master's degree, you're sputting and spewing and coughing and gagging and cussing right now, saying, no, blah, blah, blah. But that's precisely because you have a master's degree and you have drunk the Kool-Aid down to the dregs, okay? So, no, you can ask me if I have respect. The answer is no. There are many, many, many degrees where they've actually beat all the normal human sense out of you. Anyway, but all human beings, back to my thesis statement, which I stand by emphatically against all MFAers, all human beings get a kick out of seeing something faithfully rendered. So what I'm alluding to right now is just these human beings right here being, when I did the pencil work and all of a sudden, you know, if somebody had been watching me, they would have, in a sense, they would have gasped and said, oh my goodness, look at those people. Everybody gets a kick out of that. Bad dog. why do I say that? First of all, just because having just rendered something by hand, I'm made freshly aware of the degree to which human beings like to see things rendered. But, and then there's a big but coming, because there are many people in our society who in fact sort of take that to the nth degree and conclude thereby that the only really, really, really good art, or the more gooder it is, the more realistic it is, the more good it is. Okay? And as you can see, first of all, by looking at my style of artwork, I don't buy that. That's obvious. But it's not because I can't do super realistic. I can. You go to dannelsonart.com, go to my illustration page or my portrait page or my automotive page. I should be saying album. Go to my one of my those albums and you'll see that I can do realism. But as you can also see, I do not think that super realism is the best artwork. So, and I've talked about that so many times, I don't even have the energy to do it again, so I'm not going to. But really the point I wanted to make was having just rendered these figures here, I know, I'm going to say exactly, even though that's an exaggeration, I know exactly how ordinary people respond to that. And that is, ordinary people get a kick out of that. I'm still having fun doing pencils, so I guess I'll continue. sometimes it's a good idea when you're painting to just take, you know, don't finish one entire step. You know, take a break, do something else, and come back to it. That especially, again, a little bit of wisdom. I did learn this in college. Don't start at one side of your painting and finish like this or the other way. And this is related to that. You don't necessarily have to finish one aspect of your painting before you move on to something else. Very often it's a good idea to move on to something else before you get, especially before you get sick of it or tired of it. And I'm thinking about doing that, but I said, I'm really enjoying the pencil stuff, so I'm gonna stick with it. At least for the moment. I'm going in this painting. I've done painted whirly gigs, I promise, so many times over the years, so many times. And I was saying earlier, it's a real challenge. I don't enjoy painting whirly. I love the whirly gigs. If you were with me earlier today, you heard me waxing, not eloquent, effulgence, waxing rapturously about Wallace Simpson and his whirly gigs. But they are, they are essentially abstract works of art. And copying abstract works of art is problematic because you're abstracting an abstract. Does that make sense? So it's not that much fun. I've had to do that several times over the years. Like here's a parallel. Here's another example. Several years ago, I was called upon to do a painting at a festival, as a matter of fact. I was called upon to do a painting of a stained glass window. And usually I try to make it clear when I'm going to a festival. I say, I'll paint whatever you want. I've learned years ago to say, whoa, no. I will paint anything you want as long as it's not another painting. I actually had somebody do that to me one time. Woo! I did it because they were paying me and I hadn't told them ahead of time, but I learned a hard lesson. Anyway, but I hadn't said, I won't paint any stained glass windows. some patron asked me. Anyway, but that's similar to painting a whirligig. It's already a very abstract piece of art. Some of you might be saying, I don't get it. Whirligigs aren't abstract. Oh, never mind. I don't want to get into that. Yes, they are. It is an abstract. Anyway. Let me turn you around for a minute just so you can see. Basically what I'm painting, although the light I'm painting from was the light this morning, and that's not at all this light. But there's a good crowd of people out there. They're sitting at a very safe distance, I notice, from the band. The band is kind of loud. I'm pretty far away, and it's still loud.